pools and waves, pools and eddies, trout are rising for the naked eye. And the sun is shining down on the valley, hope to be a fly fish till the day that I die. Some folks like horses, cats or a dog, me I like fishing with a rod and a fly. Yes, fishing is a favorite pastime of mine. If I couldn't do it, I think I would cry. Well, life is good when I'm wading the river. It gets even better when I cast a fly. If I catch a trout, it don't really matter. It's fun just to be here and give it a try. Thought out the long bitter winter, the water is clear and the skies are blue. I'm swimming in the middle of the Delaware River, might even catch and release one or two. Stoneflies and caddis in the riffles are plenty, mayflies courting on fragrant breeze. Waxwings come down from the heavens and wait for their dinner up in the pine trees. A trout is rising in the far eddy. I make a false cast, then take my aim. If he takes the fly, I'd feel so much better. And if he doesn't, I'll feel no shame. Is cold and my waders leak. It's raining now on my favorite stream. I'll bear it all just to fish with a feather, so when I sleep I will have a sweet dream. And life is good when I'm wading the river. It gets even better when I cast a fly. If I catch a trout, I don't really matter. Just to be here and give it a try. Ripples and waves, pools and eddies, trout are rising for the mayfly. And the sun is shining down on the valley. Hope to be fly fishing till the day that I die. Hey folks, how you doing? Welcome back. This is the second episode of my Riffles and Waves program, and it's fly fishing for kids of all ages, and welcome to the show today. Last week I basically did just an intro of what we would do, and so tonight I'm going to show some more videos probably and get you all excited about fly fishing and stuff. But what we're going to do now is we're going to talk a little bit about some of the tools a fly tier would use when tying flies. You need to have a fly rod, of course, and a reel and line, and we'll cover all those other aspects of fly fishing down the road here. But in the winter time, a lot of fly fishers read books, magazines, and tie flies, unless they're a steelhead fisherman and they're brave souls who go out in the snowy weather and fly fish for salmon. So what we're going to do is, right now we're going to talk a little bit about some of the tools. So I'm going to zoom in a bit, okay, tighten up a little bit. What we have here is a vise. This is a cam lock type vise. There's rotary vises of different kinds. This is a type of rotary. It's a cheaper rotary vise, but it allows the fly to turn 360 degrees around while you're tying it. And I just found something else here. And yeah. Okay, back to the tools. Okay, we're going to have a fly tying vise. And if I had a hook here, I would show you properly how to put a hook in there, but we'll cover that when we start actually tying. What it has on here is a little spring clip here, and this allows you to put material in it to hold it there and keep it out of your way. And again, this is simply adjust by turning this and adjusting it for different hook widths, and you clamp it down and get the hook nice and tight. This one happens to be a portable version that I take along with me on my fly fishing trips, and it just simply unscrews from the base. This is a heavy base, and this goes in a fly box, fly tying box right here. And this is all I have for a fly tying kit when I go fly fishing. This has all kinds of stuff in it, as you can see, hooks, threads, blah blah blah, and we'll talk about some of this stuff here. Whoa! Need the scissors. Give me some scissors. Snip, snip. Hey, there we go. Need sharp scissors, and we'll have some thread, and that's all wound up. We have some non-toxic lead, which I should talk about. That's another tool. And some thread. Well, I have a little spool thread. In fact, I already got thread out, so forget that. Let's move on. And by the way, I'd like to mention that I am basically overwhelmed with fly tying material and gadgets and things like that. And fly fishing is a kind of a gadget person sport, okay? You rarely go into a fly shop or a fishing shop and come out with nothing. You rarely, rarely do that. So it's kind of dangerous on your bankroll in that aspect. But you really don't need to have a lot of stuff. All the stuff that I'm talking about here is the basic toolkit. In fact, while I'm talking about a basic toolkit, I'd like to mention that the first person who emails me at avkurt, that's A-V-K-U-R-T, at mac.com, mac.com. The first person to email me and say they want a free toolkit, okay, and they give me their address, I will send them out a fly kit. This has all the basic tools in it that we're going to cover here. Scissors, bobkin, half-inch tool, hackle pliers, and a bobbin, and even some thread goes along with this, and a nice pair of scissors. And this is the basic toolkit that you need. So the first person who emails me saying they would like this kit and say, hey, Mr. Kurt, I want the fly tying kit, the free fly tying kit, the first email I get at avkurt@mac.com, I will send them out. They got to give me their address and stuff, and I will ship that right out to them. Okay? Now, some of the other basic tools that you need, and again, these are just the simple requirements. You're going to need some scissors. Now, I like very small scissors, small sharp scissors, but they also have big finger holes, okay? Now, for some of you kids out there, you may be able to use just your regular bathroom scissors, and they may work fine. But when you're fly tying, a lot of times, folks will just keep the scissors in their hand and curl it around like that, and they keep working. You got to be careful, these are very sharp. But they keep working on their fly, and the scissors are always right there in their hand. All they do is they fold them down like that, and they can still function. They can pick up things and wrap thread around the hook and everything else, okay? So it really is not an impact to their tying, and they always have the scissors right there. Okay, so it's good to have big open holes for your fingers. For you kids out there, though, that may not be a big deal. You can probably just borrow a pair of scissors from your mom out of the medicine cabinet, but make sure you put them back so you don't get in trouble. Okay, now another simple tool that you'll need is what's called a hackle plier. This is my favorite one right here. This is just simply a little piece of spring steel. Okay, and it's a pliers, and it's like, ouch. They're very strong little pliers, and what this does is this holds hackle. This holds hackle on a fly, and you wrap it around the fly. Okay, here's your piece of hackle, and you take it like that, pinch it on there, and then you would wrap it around the hook. Okay, that makes the feathers stand up on edge, and thus a nice floating dry fly. We'll show more about that later. But again, these come in various different types. This one's made in India. This one is spring steel again, a little bigger, a little larger size. This one here is another teardrop, smaller size. And then this one is another good one. This one is like an old one. It's an antique model, but it's really hard spring steel. And this thing grips really good. I think the problem with these, though, is they actually grip too good, and it actually cuts the feather sometimes. So these are called hackle pliers. And again, you're going to need a vise, even a cheap one. This one here was like $35, the one that I showed you. And they range in price, and they even come cheaper than that. And you don't need a $300 vise, okay? Someday, maybe, when you have a great job, fine, buy one. But at this stage, you won't even need to think of one. Okay, we covered scissors, hackle pliers. Okay, those are two basic tools that you need. Another thing that you will need is what's called a hair stacker. And if I can find some hair, and sure enough, oh, here we go. Okay, what this is you take your scissors that I threw over here, and you would take some elk hair, moose hair, deer hair, any type of hair like that. And I'll use the small ones because this is just a small short. What this is called a hair stacker. Okay, you put it in there and you tap it on a surface and it lines. Where'd they go? Oh. And it lines the fibers up. Nice and neat. Okay, so you get the fiber tips all lined up nice and neat, and that's what you would use to tie an elk hair caddis. Very simple fly, very effective fly, and it's a fly that I will teach you, and it's a fly you're going to have in your fly tying kit or your fly box, because when they're taking caddis, that's all they're taking. And again, it's a fly that hatches all spring, summer, and fall, pretty much. Pretty reliable fly to have. Okay, now another tool you're going to need is called a bobbin. And this is a little device that allows the thread to come out, and the spring tension on the steel here, the metal here, holds on the thread, the bobbin of thread, and it keeps tension on it. So this allows you to, when you're tying your fly, to tie very tight. Look at that. My finger's turning purple already. So this is how you would tie a fly, okay? Nice and tight. Not too tight to where you break it, because this thread is very thin. This is like hair-like thread, okay? Because one of the secrets, like I said before, I think, that a dry fly is virtually weightless, where a lure or a plug is a heavy weight that's cast out with your line. That's spin casting or bait casting or whatever. But fly fishing requires a virtually lightless fly or the bait. And that's why you need this very fine thread and very fine feathers and very fine hairs that are very light, and thus the fly line will carry that line out. We'll talk more about casting. But this is a bobbin. I've got three different types. The type I like the best, it's called a flared or fluted. This has a little flute, like a trumpet, on the end of the thread here, the thread shaft here. And what this does is this prevents you from breaking the line. Sometimes you'll buy a cheaper one and it will be straight there. And as you're tying, you'll end up breaking the thread time after time, and I don't like them. And again, this is another little gadget that almost every time I'm in a fly shop, I buy another bobbin. I've got like probably 10 or 15 of these. And when I'm tying flies, I like to have a different color thread on every one. And I just like keep tying and keep tying and keep tying. If I break the thread, I just pick up another one and keep going. I don't like to waste time with that. Okay, we covered scissors. Okay, your bobbin. Your hair stacker, this is two different sizes, large one and a small one, okay? And you put the hair in there and then you pull it out and your tips will be lined up. And we covered scissors, hackle pliers and all that stuff. Another basic tool that you need is called a bodkin. And all this is simply a needle on a piece of wood. I've got some old-fashioned ones here, handmade ones. I've got, I don't know where they are, I cleaned up my desk the other day because I knew I was going to be taping the show tonight. So obviously I can't find anything that I want. But anyway, these are called bodkins, and these are used for applying head cement, which is glue or nail polish. You know, go in your sister's room, steal some clear nail polish, and you know, she'll never know. Okay, just put it back so you don't get in trouble. Okay, I used to use my sister's, and I used to always get in trouble when I was a kid. But anyway, head cement is very important. You'll put that, a little drop of that, right on the eye after you're finished tying the fly, and make sure you don't plug the eye of the hook up so you can't get line through there to tie it on your hook. So, and you use this to clean that eye out. And I also use this to tie a half hitch. And a half hitch can be tied very simply. And I use that as a holding knot a lot of times for all a half hitch is one loop around, and then you put it on the hook. Okay, so it's like that, and you take this here, you go around, and then you put it on, and there you go, you got your half hitch. And you just keep doing, you do that two or three times on the eye of the hook, and that, and then a little dot of glue on there, and that will pretty much hold your fly intact until a big old mean nasty old trout or bass or something rips it all to shreds. I have tons of flies, I tie tons of flies, and they mean a lot to me in memories. I like to retire flies and hang them up after they're all ripped to shreds, because that represents a really great day on the stream. And I don't feel bad about that. I feel pretty good having flies that are all ripped to shreds. And I've got fly boxes just full of them. And but still, use a little head cement on there to help keep your flies intact a little bit longer. And you use the bodkin with the half-hitch tool in the end. It's just a little hole that slips over the eye. And here's another size. And I like the ones that are octagon in shape because they don't roll. That's round, it'll roll off the table and you'll stick your foot or something. They're very sharp, so be careful with those. And we covered head cement. So those are your basic tools. And again, all these tools are in my little tool packet that, again, like I said earlier, the first person who emails me after this show airs will receive. It's got a bobbin, it's got a bodkin with a half-inch tool, it's got a nice pair of scissors, and a whip finisher, and it's got hackle pliers. Now, I'll cover one last tool that I don't really use a lot, but it's fun to use, and it's fun to try to figure out how to use. It's called the whip finisher, and this is just a little tool for tying a finishing knot on the eye of the fly. And again, I have to find my big hook. I got a big hook and I can't seem to find it. but I will show you that when we start tying flies, how to do the whip finish knot. Here's my giant version of the whip finisher, okay? And what I do is I will show you how to use this, and it's kind of awkward, but it does tie a nice finishing knot. And again, here's the actual size, okay? So big difference, okay? Big difference in size. Okay, this isn't a real one. This is, but this is called the whip finisher, okay? And a couple other things we use when you're at the fly shop looking around is tinsel. We use medium and wide tinsel and even thin, and it's usually silver on one side and gold on the other, economical. I also use lead-free wire to add weight to my flies that I want to sink down a few feet below the surface or even near the bottom. And in New York State, it's illegal now to use lead products, or I guess buy them, but you really shouldn't use them anyway because lead in the water is bad. So get some of this lead-free wire, different sizes, and again, this is for nymphs or streamers that you want to get down low in the water. Now, I'm the dry fly knot, and I live to dry fly fish, so but if you want to be successful fishing and fly fishing, you're going to need to have some weight, you're going to need to have some nymphs, you're going to need to have some streamers and woolly buggers and all kinds of cool stuff like that in order to be successful. Another thing you need is thread, and my favorite color is olive, and this is pretty cheap. This is, you know, I don't know, 50 cents or something. You can tie a lot of flies with one spool of thread. Now, this stuff here is olive. It's 8.0 thickness, and it comes in 3.0 and 6.0, which are the thickness. This is pretty tight stuff. This is, you know, small thread, and that will probably break pretty easy. So you got to be careful with that. But again, here's the toolkit that goes out to the first person who emails me saying they want a fly tying toolkit, and they got to send me their address so I can ship it to them, and I will get that out. Okay? And again, my email address is abkurt@mac.com. Okay? Now, what I'm going to do is take a little break here. We're going to watch a little video about a Trout Unlimited project on the West Branch of the Delaware. It was our 2002, I believe, yeah, it was this year's riverbank cleanup in the town of Deposit on the West Branch of the Delaware, one of the finest streams in the United States for fly fishing. It's a wild trout fishery. It's got wild rainbows, wild browns, and some brookies are mixed in between there. So it's a great place to fly fish, and there's no-kill sections, and it's just a great place to go. It's about 30 minutes from here in the town of Deposit. But this is a scene of our cleanup this year. We filled up two dump trucks full of truck, and I guess I got to mention this. Well, I'm the president of the chapter, so I hope you enjoy this little video, and I hope you'll be able to join us in this April when we have another cleanup in the town of Deposit, and we're looking for that to be another big success as well. So let's cut to that clip right now. Thank you. Hey folks, we've been having so much fun here, I ran out of time. So join me next week as we cover some of the materials we will use when we start darning our flies. Actually, we were having so much fun, I forgot to even cover the fly rod we're going to be building over the next several weeks. But hey, we've got all winter, we've got all spring, we got all next year. Hey, stick with me, and we'll all learn together, alright? As usual, I'm going to try to take us out with another one of my goofy songs. This one is called I Am an Animal. Yeah. Birds do it all with their beak. They eat, they clean, and they speak. And their wings take them high in the air. Who knows what they do up there? With dances, the cat be beat. Rubber necks and rubber feet tweet. Reptiles have some class. They slither about in the grass. And they're looking when the weather is dumb. Cause they party deep in the swamp. With smooth and shiny scales, long tongues and longer tails. Ooh. I am an animal. You are an animal. We both are animals. We eat like animals. We love like animals. We all are animals. We all are animals.